Hello everyone, and welcome once again to another video in which I'd be talking about the chapter "We Are Not Afraid to Die If We Can All Be Together," written by Gordon Cook and Alan East. Before starting the video, I want to tell you that this video is gonna be a long one because I have tried to include every detail that I could about boats and their structure and maps and images and sailing. Basically, I have tried to make this chapter as easy as I could for you all to understand. So, let's start. Let's start with the introduction to the chapter. The story, or the factual account presented in the chapter, talks about the sailor Gordon Cook and his family who are on a voyage round the world. Gordon Cook and his family start sailing from Plymouth, England, and they intend to cover a distance of 105,000 kilometers in 3 years. Initially, their journey is pleasant, but as they reach the southern Indian Ocean, they encounter a violent storm which causes massive destruction to their boat. Their only hope is a small 65 kilometer wide island somewhere in 150,000 kilometers of ocean. Do they find the island? Do they survive? Let's find out. Let's talk a little about Gordon Cook. Gordon Cook was originally a physics and mathematics teacher, but he went on to spend many years running tourism and other related businesses before taking on the Captain James Cook bicentenary voyage. It's the same voyage we are going to study about in this chapter. Bicentenary means 200 years. Gordon Cook decided to start his journey just 200 years after Captain James Cook had taken his third and last voyage in 1776. We are going to talk more about Captain James Cook in the coming parts of the video. Gordon Cook was married to Mary and he had two children, Suzanne and Jonathan, Sue and John. Cook was a family man with a passion that developed through his readings and research. This passion for sailing was passed on to his family, which led them to taking the voyage. Alan East was the person who helped Gordon Cook write his autobiography. Sadly, I couldn't find an authentic photo of his anywhere, so we'll have to make do without it. Let's take a look at the characters. The first one is the narrator, Mr. Gordon Cook, who is a 37-year-old businessman. Next, we have Mary, his wife, his daughter Suzanne, who is a 7-year-old girl, his son Jonathan, who is a 6-year-old boy, Larry Vigil, who is an American, and Herb Sigler, who is a Swiss. Larry Vigil and Herb Sigler are the two crewmen whom Gordon Cook takes on board to help them sail through the southern Indian Ocean. Let's have a look at the setting of the story. The story begins with Gordon Cook telling us that he, his wife Mary, his 6-year-old son Jonathan, and his 7-year-old daughter Suzanne, started sailing from Plymouth, England in July 1976. This here is Plymouth in England. The arrow is pointing out to Plymouth, which you can see is situated along the English Channel. They wanted to go on a round-the-world voyage just like Captain James Cook, who had done the same 200 years. This here is a photo of Captain James Cook. Captain James Cook was born on 7th November 1728. He died. He was killed on 14th February 1779. He was a British explorer, a navigator, a cartographer. A cartographer is a person who makes maps. He was a captain in the British Royal Navy and he circumnavigated the world thrice. First in the year 1768, then in 1772, and the third and his last time in 1776, during which he was killed in Hawaiian Islands during the last voyage while he was returning. So, Mr. Gordon Cook lets us know that he and his wife had dreamt of sailing in the wake of Captain James Cook for the longest time. In the wake means following someone or something. So they had decided to take the same route that was taken by Captain James Cook in his third and his last voyage. They had spent the past 16 years honing their seafaring skills in British waters. Honing means sharpening or perfecting something over a period of time. And seafaring skills means the skills which you need to travel and survive in the sea. British waters is actually the sea, the part of the sea, the Atlantic Ocean or the English Channel that is there beside England, that is there under the control of England, that is British waters. Now let me tell you a little about their boat, which they called Wave Walker. Wave Walker was 23 meters in length and its weight was 30 tons. It was a wooden hulled boat. Now what is a hull? Hull is the watertight body of a ship or a boat. A hull may be open at the top, such as a dinghy, or it may be fully or partially covered with a deck. Here, this is an image of the hull of a boat. You can see the entire covered section, the entire body of the boat, which is covered with planks of wood. That is the hull of a boat. This boat, Wave Walker, was professionally built and it was tested in the roughest weather that they could find in English Channel or in the Atlantic Ocean. And now we come to the first part of the chapter, that is when their journey starts. So the journey started with their sailing from Plymouth, England, as we have already discussed. They started their journey in July 1976. According to Gordon Cook, this leg means part. This part of their journey was quite pleasant. They sailed down the west coast of Africa to Cape Town. Let me show you an image. Here is the image of Europe and Africa. In this yellow circle, you can see England, the map of England. And this is the route that they took to reach Cape Town. They made a halt at Cape Town and they took two crewmen on board. First was Larry Vigil, he was an American, and second was Herb Sigler, he was Swiss. These two men would help the narrator sail through one of the world's roughest seas, that is the Indian Ocean, the southern part of the Indian Ocean. Here in this map you can see the Indian Ocean, and this is the route they had to take. They had to reach Australia, so this is the route they would be taking. You can see it's a vast area of sea with no land nearby. Second part, the storm. The Wave Walker began experiencing strong gales since the second day of their starting from Cape Town, and these gales blew continuously for the next few weeks. Gales are actually strong winds that blow in the seas. According to Mr. Gordon Cook, not the gales but the size of the waves, which were up to 15 meters, was alarming him. The size of the waves were as high as their main mast. This is the structure of a boat. The main mast of a boat is the tallest pole, which is usually made up of wood or metal. It is erected more or less vertically on the center line of a ship or a boat. Its purposes include carrying sails, giving necessary height to a navigation light. It also acts as a lookout position. Large ships usually have several masts, with the size and configuration or arrangement of the masts depending on the style of a ship. There wasn't any improvement in the weather even on December 25th. By now, they were about 3,500 kilometers east of Cape Town. Despite the atrocious weather, the sailing team celebrated Christmas on board. They even had brought a Christmas tree along with them. The weather remained the same even on New Year. They hoped the weather would change. And the weather did change. It became worse. On the 2nd of January, they were sailing with a small storm jib, yet they were moving very fast. The scene was horrifying. Whenever they rose on the top of a wave, they could see endless enormous waves rolling towards them. The sound was just deafening. So to protect the boat from sinking or from capsizing, they took some steps. First, they dropped or lowered the small storm jib in order to slow down the boat. In order to understand what a storm jib is, you first need to understand what a sail is. A sail is a strong piece of fabric which is hoisted on a main mast or a mast to help the boat sail forward. On the right hand side image, you can see what a mainsail is. The base of a mainsail is called boom, and a mainsail is hoisted on a mast. The wind puts pressure on the sail and hence the boats keep moving forward. But during storms or winds or gales, when gales are blowing, mainsails are taken down and smaller storm jibs are hoisted. These storm jibs are small triangular sails which are hoisted when the wind speed is very high and the mainsail has to be taken down. Wind puts less pressure on a storm jib and it helps the boat move ahead without swaying the boat. They usually have a bright orange color for better visibility. The next step that they took was lashing and double lashing a heavy mooring rope in a loop across the stern. Let us try to understand what is the mooring rope, what is lashing, and what is stern. Here is an image of some mooring ropes. Mooring ropes are strong ropes specifically made for sailing boats, ships. These ropes are very useful in tying the cargo or in tying the boat or a ship to a harbor. They are used for anchoring ships and boats also. They are specifically tied in a special type of sailor's knot, a knot that is virtually impossible for people like you or me to tie. We have to take some lessons, but it's not that impossible. However, these ropes are used for tying cargo or for tying boats to the harbors, or to tie ships to the anchors or to the harbors. They are strong ropes specifically made for sea and to endure the salty seawater. This here is a structure of a boat where you can see that the front part is called the bow. The back side is known as the stern. The right hand side is called a starboard, the starboard side, and the left hand side is known as the port side. This here is a stern of a boat. You can see the large amount or the vast amount of storage space that is available, and that is why several engine parts, spare engines, cargoes, some dinghies, life rafts, etc. are kept stored on this part of the boat, and so mooring ropes are usually used in order to tie the cargo, and that is what our sailors did. They tied and double tied and secured everything, all the cargo that they had on the stern of their boat using a heavy mooring rope. The next thing that they did is going through a life raft drill. This here is a life raft. A life raft is a raft or a small boat or a dinghy that is present on every ship or boat. In case a ship or a boat starts capsizing or drowning, the people are supposed to get on this life raft, which already has several items to sustain these people for days. These rafts are filled and well fitted with food supplies, water, and other small temporary sailing equipments. They are usually of a bright color for better visibility. Life raft drills are very common and they are necessitated by law sometimes. In the countries of US, life raft drills are necessitated by law, which requires all the people sailing to do this drill from time to time. How they would get on to a life raft in case the boat or the ship goes down, the ship is hijacked, or it starts capsizing. So that's life raft drill. And that is exactly what these people started doing, or these people undertook once they realized that they are going to face a very challenging storm. The next thing that they did is attaching lifelines to their bodies. Now this here are lifelines. They are usually these railings which are placed or erected or constructed by the sides of the boats, so that people on the boats, on the deck of a boat, should not fall overboard into water. However, we are going to talk about a different kind of lifeline in this chapter. These are also lifelines. You can see that this man has fastened a sort of a rope with a clasp to his body, to a belt on his body. The other end of that rope has been fastened to some other part of the boat. This would allow free movement for this man without falling into the water. Or even if this man falls into the water, this lifeline would always help him come back to the boat. Here's another image. You can see that this orange colored rope is the lifeline. One end of this lifeline is tied to the belt of this man's body, and the other end of this lifeline has been fastened to some other part of the boat. Even if this man falls overboard into water, he can always come back on board by the help or with the help of these lifelines. And the last thing that they did to protect themselves was wearing oilskins and life jackets. The word that the narrator has used is donned. Donned means wearing or wore. They wore oilskins and life jackets. These type of clothes are known as oilskins. They are waterproof clothes, and they also usually have a bright color for easy visibility. And as you all know, these are life jackets. Again, they have a very bright color for easy visibility. On 2nd January 6 p.m., there was an ominous silence. The wind completely dropped. The sky completely grew dark. There was a growing roar in the environment, and the roar kept growing and growing. Suddenly, our narrator noticed a huge cloud at the aft of the boat. Aft means the stern of the boat. And then the narrator realized that it's not a cloud, it's an enormous wave like no other that he had ever seen. The wave was almost vertical, and it was twice the length of all the other waves that he had seen. And he saw that the wave had a frightful breaking crest. Crest means head. The head of the wave was breaking frightfully. At first, he hoped to ride over the wave. Here you can see this enormous wave and how frightfully its head or its crest is breaking. At first, he really hoped that he would be able to ride over the wave something like this. He thought that he would be able to pass the wave. But disaster struck. A tremendous explosion shook the deck. This is a deck. It's the upper platform of a boat or a ship where people can walk or store cargo. There was water everywhere, green and white, frothy water everywhere on the deck. Gordon Cook's head smashed into the navigation wheel. This here is a navigation wheel. It is like a steering wheel for a boat or a ship. In this image, the navigation wheel is inside a cabin, but originally on Wave Walker, Gordon Cook's navigation wheel was outside on the deck. And as soon as Cook's head smashed into the navigation wheel, he suddenly went overboard out into the water and sank below the waves. And there he began losing consciousness. He saw death approaching and he felt really peaceful. But suddenly his head popped out of the water as if some miracle. And at a distance he saw the wave walker was capsizing. Its masts were almost horizontal with the surface of the sea. Something like this. This is a capsizing boat, and you can see that the main mast of the boat is almost going to become horizontal within a few minutes. Another wave hurled or threw the wave walker upright. So another wave came and the wave walker was suddenly thrown upright. Now it's not capsizing anymore. And Gordon Cook's lifelines, with which he had attached himself to the boat, they suddenly jerked taut. They suddenly got pulled tight. And hence, he was pulled back on board the boat. So he held the guardrails. These are the guardrails. So he held the guardrails and he landed on the main boom. This here, the base of the main sail that we had discussed earlier, is the boom. So he landed on the boom. Straight away landed on the boom. This is how a boom looks when the sails are taken down. Another image for your clarification. So this is how a boom looks when the sails are taken down and tied onto it. Later on, when the sails would be hoisted, the sails would be reopened, uncovered, and hoisted on the main mast. After landing on the main boom, for a few minutes, he was tossed around the deck like a rag doll. He was thrown here and there, and in all that tossing around and getting thrown around due to the waves and the water, his ribs cracked, his teeth broke, and his mouth was filled with blood. He took the wheel finally, and he somehow aligned the stern to ride over the next wave. He readied the boat for the next wave to come. Suddenly, Mary came through the hatch and informed about the smashed decks underneath and the flooding of water. Gordon Cook asked Mary to take the wheel and he went down the hatch. This here is the image of a hatch. These hatch doors are specifically or typically situated on a deck, which allows people to come out or go down to the lower level decks. Larry and Herb were pumping out water using water pumps. There was broken timber. Timber is wood. So there were broken timber hanging everywhere at the lower level decks. Things were floating and moving about in deep water. The whole starboard side had bulged inwards from the impact of the wave. We had already decided, I had already told you that starboard side is the right hand side of the boat and it had bulged inwards with due to the impact of the enormous wave. So Gordon Cook went to check on his children after that. He saw that they were all right, but Susan had a big bump on her forehead which hurt her tremendously. Finally, they start taking control of the damage that the wave has caused to their boat. The first thing that they do is securing the holes with waterproof canvas cloth and waterproof hatch covers. This here is a hatch cover. What they do is they put the canvas cloth, they hold it over the holes, and then they place these hatch covers, fasten these hatch covers, secure it nicely so that the holes are nicely secured so that no water should come in through those holes. These hatch covers are specifically made for these purposes. Suddenly they realized that their hand pumps, which they were using for pumping out water, they got blocked with debris. Debris is the broken material of things. Broken material. And because their hand pumps were getting blocked, the water level started rising. So our narrator remembered that he had two spare pumps somewhere on the stern of the boat. He went to check and found that both the spare hand pumps, the forestay sail, the jib, the dinghies, the main anchor, everything had fallen overboard. This here is a kind of a dinghy. Finally, our narrator found an electric pump under the chart room floor and it worked. Chart room is a room on a boat which is specifically made for consulting charts and other things. Navigation equipments are stored in chart room. Finally, they kept on pumping out water using that electric pump and they kept on steering the boat, trying to save themselves from different enormous waves, and this entire routine went on throughout the whole night. They tried working the radio, but all their Mayday calls went unanswered. Mayday calls are emergency or distress calls. Susan's head was badly swollen. She had enormous black eyes. Her eyes had become two slits. There was also a deep cut on her arm, which she showed now for the first time. When asked why she hadn't shown all that injury, she told her parents that she didn't want to worry all of them when they were actually trying to save everyone else. Such a wise thing coming out from a 7-year-old girl. On the 3rd of January, the water level was sufficiently under control and they could take 2 hours rest in rotation. Yet they believed that there was a leak somewhere under the water line through which water was still coming in. Now this is the water line. The portion above the water line is usually the portion that is visible to us, and the portion below the water line remains submerged underwater. This is another image which shows you that the portion above the waterline, the hull of the boat, usually remains visible to us, and the portion below the waterline, the keel, it usually is not visible to us because it's submerged underwater. Upon checking, these people found that nearly all the rib frames were smashed down to the keel. So they went and checked and they found that all the rib frames of the boat, they were completely smashed down to the keel, up to the keel. So this image shows us what a keel is. Keel is the portion below the waterline. The bottom of a boat is the keel. The red painted section is the keel of the boat. Rib frames are usually attached to the keel. Now, what are rib frames? These are the rib frames of a boat. These rib frames provide structure to a boat. You can see that they are connected to the keel or the bottom part of the boat. Wooden planks are placed or attached onto these rib frames to give the whole boat its smooth shape. Here you can see that wooden planks are being attached onto the rib frames of the boat to give the boat its look, smooth look. They realized that the boat was so damaged that it wouldn't hold together for long enough for all of them to reach Australia. And they also found out that their spare engine was out of action. Now they were running only with one engine. If something happens, they would be stranded in the middle of this ocean. So Gordon Cook checked his charts and calculated that there should be 2 islands a few hundred kilometers to the east. One of them, Isle Amsterdam, was a French scientific base. Scientific base means it was an island owned by the French, and scientific research work related to geology, biology, related to geography was done. Research work was done on that island. But these 2 small islands were like pinpricks in the vast ocean. By 4th January, they had reached the last few centimeters of water. Now they just had to keep track with whatever water came in through those small gaps in the holes. They just have to keep pumping that out, otherwise the water was sufficiently under control, just a last few centimeters of water was remaining. Now they waited for the wind to go down so that they could hoist any sail in the strong wind. Any pressure on the sails, they couldn't hoist any sails actually. Any pressure on the sails would put pressure on the rigging, and pressure on the rigging would pull the whole damaged section of the boat apart. So what is rigging? The entire system of ropes, cables, chains on a boat is called rigging. Rigging supports the sails, they support the mast, and they control the boat, and they prevent the boat from getting blown sideways by strong winds. So that is what rigging does. So they hoisted the small storm jib, the same storm jib that they had taken out as a preventive measure before the storm started. So they hoisted this small storm jib. All the other jibs had also gone overboard into the water, as we had talked about a few minutes ago in the same video. So finally they headed for where they thought the islands might be, those two islands, Isle Amsterdam and the other island. Mary found some corned beef and cracker biscuits, which was actually their first meal in almost 2 days. But by 4 p.m. that day, black clouds began appearing once again, and the wind was back to 40 knots and the seas were getting higher. Knots is actually the short form of nautical miles. Knot is the unit of speed, which is equal to 1 nautical mile per hour. And if we talk about kilometers, so nautical mile is exactly 1 nautical mile is exactly 1.852 kilometer per hour. Knot is also the unit for measuring distance when you are at sea or when you are in an aircraft. 5th January. By the dawn of 5th January, their situation was back to desperate. Jonathan came and asked Gordon if they were really going to die, and the narrator tried to assure him that they would make it to the island. To that, John replied, "But Daddy, we aren't afraid to die if we can all be together, you and Mummy, Sue and I." This made the narrator even more determined to find a way out of the storm. And this is the exact dialogue from which our chapter gets its name. So now the narrator decided to do something to protect the boat, because they had to preserve the boat until they reached the island. So for that, the narrator decided to heave to. Now heave to is a process which sailors do in order to slow down their boat or to stop their boat on the sea. In order to slow down their boat, he used an improvised sea anchor, because their main anchor had gone down into the water, it was thrown into the water. So he tried to make an improvised sea anchor, for which he used 2 plastic barrels of paraffin oil, 22 liters each. He tied both the barrels together neatly, properly, using the ropes that they had, and they used it as a sea anchor. They dropped it into the sea, the boat stopped moving, and finally the narrator turned the boat and turned the port side of the boat towards the oncoming waves. Till now, the starboard side was facing the oncoming waves, but now the narrator decided to turn the port side towards the oncoming waves so that any more impact of the waves should not harm the starboard side. This would protect the starboard side. The port side is undamaged, so he faced the port side towards the oncoming waves to protect the starboard side. The motion of the boat still brought water through the broken wooden planks. That evening, Gordon and Mary sat together holding hands, and they felt that the end was near. Although they had tried to do everything that was possible, that they were able to do to protect the boat, to protect the entire crew, but they felt they were failing somehow. However, by the morning of 6th January, the wave walker rode out of the storm. And this here is the end of our second part and the beginning of our third part, finding the island. So by the morning of the 6th January, They had come out of the storm, and now Gordon tried to take a reading on the sextant. Now this here is a sextant. It is a device that sailors use to calculate the distance on the sea. This is how sailors take a reading on sextant. So Gordon tried to get a reading on that sextant, and he worked on wind speeds. He worked on the change of course, drift and current of water, and he did all this in order to calculate their position and the position of Isle Amsterdam, that island in the vast open sea. But it was extremely difficult to do so, especially after the wind had displaced them unexpectedly from their route. You can see the map over here. Those two small pinpricks are the two islands, Isle Amsterdam and Isle St. Paul, and they have to reach there. This here is an aerial image of this small island called Isle Amsterdam. It has to be very difficult to be found because of its very small size. More encouragement was in waiting for our narrator from his daughter. Now Susan came in moving very painfully, her head swollen badly, her eyes completely black, and they were like two narrow slits or cuts. But she gave a card to Gordon in which she had drawn the caricatures. Caricatures are the figures of Mary and the narrator with these words: "Here are some funny people. Did they make you laugh? I laughed a lot as well." Inside was a message: "Oh, how I love you both." So this card is to say thank you, and let's hope for the best. Gordon Cook knew he had to make it. So he began checking and rechecking using a spare compass, because they had lost the main compass. And this spare compass did not work properly, but he made an allowance for this. Made an allowance for this means he still tried to use it. Although Gordon wasn't confident, yet at 2 p.m. he went down. He told Larry confidently to steer the boat 185 degrees and he would find the island by 5 p.m. Now he told this to Larry with a lot of confidence, but according to Gordon, he himself wasn't much confident about this. And then he went to sleep. And he slept soundlessly. He had a sound sleep. Suddenly he woke up at 6 p.m. and knew that they had failed to locate the island because nobody had come to wake him up. And he was deeply disappointed because with this broken boat, one engine, one sail, no proper compass, all the sailing equipments down, drowned into the water, they couldn't go back into the storm. But suddenly Sue and Jonathan came, gave Gordon a hug and called him the best daddy in the world because he had found the island. It was out there as big as a battleship. So Gordon went to the deck to see the stark outline of the beautiful island, which was just a piece of volcanic rock with little vegetation. But for them, this was the most beautiful island in the world. They anchored offshore that night, and the next morning, all the 28, yes, only 28 inhabitants of the island helped and welcomed the whole crew ashore. Offshore means a little away from the shore. Finally, towards the end of the chapter, our narrator, Mr. Gordon Cook, appreciates and remembers the contribution of these people in sailing through the roughest times of their life. Larry and Herb, who were absolutely optimistic and cheerful under direst stress. Mary, who stayed at the wheel for all those crucial hours, and she steered the boat away from trouble during all that time. She was out there, exposed to the waves and handling the boat like a pro. And he thought of his 7-year-old daughter, Sue, who did not want to worry them about her head, and later on her head took 6 minor operations to remove a recurring blood clot between skin and skull. Recurring means occurring again and again and again. So this blood clot was occurring again and again, and it took about 6 minor operations to remove it. And he thought about his 6-year-old boy, Jonathan, who was not afraid to die. And that's the end of the story. This chapter, We Are Not Afraid to Die, is a story of unity, extraordinary courage, determination, indomitable spirit, and the never say die attitude. The story speaks volumes about the bond of love and emotional support that a family shares at all times. It beautifully highlights the struggle of each member of the family and the combined efforts of all the members that helped them survive such a catastrophic event. The story also shows the struggles of a father who is determined to save his family, and he would leave no stone unturned to bring the situation under control. He also brings the combined efforts of each character to fight this situation. The little boy Jonathan exhibits a great deal of courage and is also ready to die if his family members are together. All that matters is that they are together. The young girl Suzanne, she is seriously injured but chooses not to bother her father, who is struggling to save everyone. The various trials and tribulations that the sailing crew went through make this story a fantastic read, which is both aspirational and heartwarming. And let's talk about the aftermath. What happens after this? This here is Gordon Cook, the man on the left, Gordon Cook. Yes, he has grown old. He's not 37 anymore in this image. So, the Shipwrecked Mariners Royal Benevolent Society has recently presented Mr. Gordon Cook with the Lady Swaddling Trophy, which is awarded annually for an outstanding feat of seamanship and navigation. Actually, this award was declared just after the horrifying adventure the family and the crew had faced. However, the award couldn't be given then because Gordon Cook and his family spent almost 17 years sailing in the Southern Hemisphere, and hence they couldn't be contacted for the prize. When the prize was declared, they couldn't be contacted. It was believed that Sue and Jordan was unable to attend normal schools, and so people had doubts about their education. They were taught by their mother throughout the voyage, despite both parents' worries that the children would suffer educationally. Yet they went on to gain doctorates from Cambridge and Cranfield universities respectively. So their education did suffer, but they had nothing to lose. Here is an image of the family. This is a photo which was taken at CYC Rushcutters Bay, Australia on 8th of November 1977, the same year when they met that storm. That devastating storm in the month of January. This is the month of November. You can still see the huge bump on Sue's forehead, but I guess the operation has already taken place, so the blood clot is not there, but a slight bump can be seen on Sue's forehead. So they have stopped here to collect some provisions, and they would be moving ahead. They would be sailing ahead after this. This here is another image of the same family at the same, taken at the same place, same day. You can see how small the kids are, and you can also see this navigation wheel against which Gordon Cook had banged his head. You can see it's not inside a cabin, it's out there on the deck. A man can be seen in the background, which might be Herb Sigler or Larry Vigil. This here are some images of the family. You can see the two children, the mother at the background, and the father also on the deck by the navigation wheel. This here is a photo of a whale that the family encountered much later. This photo was taken much later. This is the press coverage of the family's unusual adventure. You can see on the top left hand corner the image of the boat Wave Walker. That's the end of our video. Do you have any questions related to this chapter? If you have, please write in the comment box below. If you liked my video, give a thumbs up, share it with your friends, tell them about this video, and please subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching. Adios.